Hello everyone, and welcome back to my channel. My name is Dr. Stephen Roth, and I'm a board-certified oral and maxillofacial pathologist, and today is the first installment in my syndrome series, where I'll be discussing various syndromes that have manifestations in the head and neck, and today's episode is on cherubism. But first, we gotta get into the disclaimer, and that is that all of the opinions expressed in this video are mine and mine alone and do not represent any organization that employs me or that I may be a part of. And also, this video is for educational purposes only and should not serve as medical advice. Should you have any concerns about your oral health, please see your nearest oral health care provider. And with that being said, let's get into the video. So cherubism is an autosomal dominant syndrome, but many of the cases arise de novo, which means of the new, meaning that it doesn't arise from inheritance, but instead comes from an independent genetic mutation. So cherubism is the result of a gain of function mutation of the SH3BP2 gene, which is on the short arm of the fourth chromosome. And the results of that gene mutation is enhanced stability of the 3BP2 adaptor protein. That adapter protein enhances osteoclastogenesis. Now, osteoclasts are the specific type of cell that help break down bone during remodeling. The natural lifespan of our bone is constantly breaking down and remodeling throughout our entire life. But when patients have cherubism, there is increased bone breakdown and increased osteoclasts. And what do osteoclasts look like under the microscope? Well, they look like multinucleated giant cells, or the chocolate chip cookies you may have heard me talk about before. So how does this manifest clinically? Well, it creates bilaterally symmetrical enhancement or expansion of the mandible. And that leads to very round faces with somewhat more plump cheeks, and that's how cherubism gets its name. Many of the patients that have cherubism look like the cherubs, or the little baby angels, from Renaissance paintings. And so many people thought that these patients had somewhat of a similar facies to those Renaissance paintings, and that's how cherubism got its name. Severe cases of cherubism that involve the lateral and inferior orbit may actually result in a tilting of the eye upwards and a retraction of the lower eyelid, and that can result in sort of an eyes pointing towards heaven, which continues with this cherub theme. So radiographically, what it looks like is bilateral, expansile, multilocular radiolucencies of the mandible. And that may sound familiar to you, so if you watched my Mocha Macho video, there is a differential for multilocular radiolucencies of the mandible. But bilaterally, there's really only two aspects of that Mocha and Macho that really come to mind. And that could be OKCs, which would be part of another syndrome I plan to cover in the future, nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome. But it also probably more likely represents a cherubism, being that they are bilateral giant cell lesions. Now, we usually call those central giant cell granulomas, but they're not really granulomas, so for the rest of the video, I'll just be referring to them as giant cell lesions. So when we look at cherubism under the microscope, it looks exactly like a central giant cell granuloma. There is one special finding that is helpful in making a diagnosis of cherubism if we aren't given the radiograph at the time of biopsy, and that is this eosinophilic or red-pink cuffing around the vessels in that biopsy specimen. Now, this is a very specific finding, meaning that we don't really see it outside of cherubism, but it's not very sensitive, meaning that not all biopsies of cherubism are going to have it. You really do kind of get lucky if you see it in a biopsy specimen. But most of the time, we know it's probably cherubism based on the clinical presentation and also the fact that it is symmetrical and bilateral central giant cell lesions in a younger patient. So is cherubism the only syndrome where you can get multiple giant cell lesions? Well, no, it's a differential in and of itself. So we can see multiple giant cell lesions in Noonan and Noonan-like syndrome, in Jaffe-Campanacci syndrome, which has quite a bit of overlap with neurofibromatosis type 1, and neurofibromatosis type 1 can also have multiple multinucleated giant cell lesions in the jaw. It also can be seen in Ramone syndrome, which has a lot of overlap with cherubism. A few extra findings in Ramone syndrome include gingival fibromatosis, hypertrichosis, which means extra hair, the cherubism lesions, and also some intellectual delay. But far and away, the most common that I have come across in my practice, if it's bilateral giant cell lesions in bone, is cherubism. So what can you do for patients with cherubism? Well, there are many options. The most conservative option is to watch and wait. There's a suggestion that these are self-limiting, and when the patient reaches puberty, then the lesions stop growing and they actually undergo regression, meaning that they shrink, and over time, the natural movement of the muscles of the face, the facial expression muscles, and the muscles of mastication causes the jaw bones to start to go back to a more normal appearance over time due to the compression of the musculature against the expanded bone. And since the lesions regress, that allows for the patient to resume a more normal facies without any surgical intervention. There are other interventions such as intralesional steroid injection, intralesional rank L inhibitors like a denosumab, enucleation and curettage, and then the most extreme is resection of the lesions, which obviously would be removal of large segments of mandibular bone in a young patient. And they may have some ability to grow some new bone back, but probably limited. And it will vary based on a case-to-case basis and based on the needs of the patient. If the patient is amenable to having a more plump facies, then they might go with the more conservative option. Whereas if they prefer a more active intervention, then they may elect for a more aggressive option. That concludes the first installment of the syndrome series. I do hope that you enjoyed it. If you did, be sure to give this video a like and share it with someone else that may enjoy it as well. And to make sure that you don't miss any future installments of the syndrome series, make sure you subscribe and turn on that bell notification. Thank you for watching and be well.